I kind of always had a little thing for piano when I was a kid. And then one day, this is really funny. One day I was watching Popeye, and Popeye was playing piano. And I was a huge Popeye fan, you know, like I ate spinach. Back then I ate spinach every day. Obviously I don't eat more, but you know, I was eating spinach and Popeye played the piano for olive oil. And I was like, I would be like Popeye playing the piano. But I could already kind of play by ear a little bit. I was 4 years old at the time. I was 4 years old. And so my mom was like, you know, you kind of play a little bit. Let's find your piano teacher. And coincidentally, my piano teacher lived on the same neighborhood as the block over. You know, so it was like, I took lessons. Matter of fact, the last song on my record is called A Requiem for Carolyn. And it's dedicated to her. She taught me classical. She taught me a lot. You know, I grew up in the church, so I played gospel forever. You know, but her whole thing was, gospel, well, jazz, classical, and she taught me theory and music history. You know, because her whole thing was, she'd rather me be a fully accomplished musician as opposed to being like a bootleg musician. So she was like, you know, the Baroque period, the classical period, the romantic, contemporary, you know that stuff. You know what all that's about, what all's involved in that. You need to know the theory, you need to know all that kind of stuff. So that's what she taught me. Well, I couldn't play basketball in the back of my yard very much. it was one of those things where, I had to make sure that I practiced 2 hours a day, every day. And I'll never forget, as long as I'm living, my friends were playing basketball in my backyard, while I was playing too. My mom came out, she said, "Did you practice 2 hours a day?" And I was like, "No, ma'am." And she said, "You come in here and you practice your 2 hours." But she told my friends, she said, "Y'all can keep playing. You can play as long as you want to. But he has to come in here and practice 2 hours. And I was like, oh my gosh, which is so embarrassing because I got to hear the ball bouncing in the back of the yard while I'm playing C major scales, But, at the same token, what it taught me was discipline over everything. You have plenty of time to have fun. Once you make it a point to be disciplined, one thing, do that, get it done, and do everything else you want to do. At about 14 or 15 years old, because at that point, I had been doing, for 10 years, and so it was just kind of like ingrained, And I mean, even now, at 30 years old, what I'm saying? It's like, I wake up and I drive my wife crazy because I just go in and start practicing scales for hours. Yeah, she's like, what is it? Well, now she's used to it, but it was like, what is that noise? Well, I had to get it in, Do I remember the first record I ever bought?
Yep.
Hell yeah. New Edition. It was 1980. What year was that? It was the Cool It Now record. And so me and my homeboy, we went to Sound Warehouse and bought Cool It Now by New Edition. And that was the first record I ever heard. I was like, oh man. And it had the song, Mr. Telephone Man, there's something wrong with my life. Hey man, we heard that record. It was like, oh my gosh. Cause it was so smooth. It was real chill. Man, please, I remember that. I still have that record right now.
The same exact copy.
Not scratched, it's in great condition. Yeah, man, absolutely. We bought what else did we buy that day? We bought Cool It Now record, we bought there was a Michael Jackson record that came out like around the same time, and we bought that too. It wasn't Thriller, it wasn't Off The Wall. It was like something like obscure. But yeah, we absolutely. That's the first record I bought that changed my mind about music. You know, because honestly, you know, listening to that record, you know, it taught me a lot about production. You know, it taught me a lot about, you know, producing, making sure the vocals were kind of out front. You know, listen to the drums, where they were. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Good time. Ooh, y'all have a keyboard player here named Nigel Hall. That's the worst part about being there. Let me tell you why, because he is a Redskins fan. And I don't get it. And I'm a Cowboys fan from Dallas, Texas. I'm a Cowboys fan. I even had the star put on my neck. I'm a real Cowboys fan. You know. And he's a Redskins fan. And I don't get it. Why are you a Redskins fan? Redskins ain't done nothing ever. You know what I'm saying? But you know, but hey. This, that, and third. But my favorite part about New Orleans, I love the culture. I love the people. Everybody here is so cool. The food is amazing. You know, you can walk down the street with your red Solo cup and nobody's gonna bother you. You know what I'm saying? You know, New Orleans is just a great place. You know, it's a great place. You know, and there's so much to be said. There's so much to be told about the city of New Orleans, about the state of Louisiana as a whole. As a matter of fact, my piano teacher is actually from Alexandria, Louisiana, and she's buried there. Like even now, she's buried there, and that's, you know. And it was like her soul, her style, and she was like a 4'11" white lady. You know what I'm saying? You know, but she could play jazz and the blues like it was nobody's business, you know. And so I've always had this thing for, you know, New Orleans, Louisiana, Shreveport, Alexandria, you know, Ruston, all of the state is a beautiful thing. But I'm right in Texas. I'm not far, you know. So everything kind of cross bleeds, you know. A lot of the other tours that I've done, you know, with I'll say major artists, you know, it's normally this, but I've always respected the hustle of Snarky Puppy, you know. So it was like, you know, I remember one day, I literally went from staying in the Ritz-Carlton in Detroit to sleeping on somebody's floor in Lafayette, Louisiana, with Snarky Puppy. And it was like, I love sleeping on the floor. You know what I'm saying? Like, I was in Detroit, Michigan, Ritz-Carlton. Everything was great. You know, I got room service. I got, you know, this, that, and third. It was like, yeah, but the music that I'm in, the Snarky, is like, you know, it's worth that bus ride. It's worth that van ride. You know what I'm saying? That was really cool. Practice when you're on tour is the stage, like, you know, or sound check, if you will. You know, it's kind of hard being consistent with a practice regimen. But when you're on tour, especially with a band like Snarky Puppy, you know, it's like, you know, every minute is going to challenge you. It's just one of those things where, you know, when you have to get it in. But the thing about it is that you have to get it in, because you have to be able to hang with these idiots. You know what I'm saying? You know, Chris Bullock, you know, Mike Meyer, Mike Lee, you know, Bob Lanzetti, you know, JayTee or Spud, or it's like, you have to be able to hang with these guys. So you gotta put something in, you know, at some point. And a lot of times what we'll all do is, cause I'm a producer as well. And so, you know, so a lot of times during the off time, you know, we'll, you know, compose songs and produce tracks. Like, I literally just finished mixing Kirk Franklin record last Monday, you know, and I had to do everything like on the go, like, you know, I had to go to Nashville, sit with John Yash, had to move around, you know, because it had to be done. Well, this tour right now is just starting. We just started Friday, you know, so I'm sure things will get real ignorant by like Wednesday. Because it normally takes about 7 days for everybody to understand that we're on tour. But we did do this great, this really, really great clinic earlier with a bunch of kids. And it was really, really cool. And there was this one little kid named Caitlin. She was like 9 years old. And she had the smallest hands in the world. But she was, you know, playing, you know, piano. And I really enjoyed that. Because it took me back to when I was her age, you know, so, you know, if not younger. And it was like, you know, you want to do so much, but your hands will only let you do so much, you know, but you're taking all the stuff and like you're absorbing all the stuff, you know. And that was really cool. It was at, what was the name of that place?
Is that the Tipitina's Foundation?
Tipitina's, yep. Yeah, that was, and that was a lot of fun. That was really, really a lot of fun. I was tired. I was like, I didn't even know who was going to do it, you know, because on the schedule it said TBD, you know, but we had a really good time doing it. A really good time. Piano is a percussion instrument, you know. I mean, it is literally classified, you know, because everything is, you know, when you hit a note, it strikes a string, and so it's considered a percussion instrument. But the thing about it is that, you know, it's a percussion instrument with finesse. You know what I'm saying? You know, you have to be able to finesse everything, and that's one thing Miss Campbell would always, you know, say that. She's like, you know, you don't have to play everything hard. You know, you can play. You know, you can play soft, you can play, you know, in different, different levels of volume. And that was one of the things that, you know, that I learned, which is why, like even on Seven Summers, you know, a Requiem for Crown is very soft, it's very simple. Madiba is hard, you know, it's hard hitting, but that's because, you know, when I landed in Johannesburg, South Africa in 2013, you know, I watched everybody in the street party after they found out that Nelson Mandela died. But they weren't partying soft. Like, they were partying hard. I was like, who parties when somebody dies? like, where they do that at? You know? But I'm gonna tell you something. It was the biggest party I've ever seen before in my entire life. You know, and it taught me something. It really taught me something. It was like, you know what? I want people to celebrate the fact that I lived and not the fact that. You know what I'm saying? So, and so one thing about the piano is that you're able to pull out all these different emotions out of it. And that's the one thing I've always loved about it. Yeah, this is gonna sound so bad. The new Scarface record is really inspiring me. Kendrick Lamar, Dr. Dre, Kamasi Washington is really inspiring me a whole lot. Hiatus Coyote, let's look and see. There are a lot. I have like these random playlists that are like Avery Sunshine. I'm a gospel dude, so you know Anthony Brown, Group Therapy. I'm a homegirl from Dallas, Chatty Crystal, D'Angelo, Vanguard. Which is, then I still love this Genesis record, and I can't let it go. I really cannot let it go. And I've been trying, but I just, you know. I can't let it go. And my whole thing, I'd be like, okay, Lord, look, I pray a lot. I'd be like, look here, Lord. is there something that you want me to do with this song, like rearrange it or put it in my show or what? And I think I'm gonna put it in my show. So when I come back, I'm coming back here in November to Gossip Gossip. And so I'm gonna learn the words, I'm gonna sing it, and I'm gonna play it in my show. So y'all, so y'all gotta come out. It was a long journey. That's for sure. You know, my friend who's now, you know, deceased, my friend Eric Hartman, he really helped me out with like a lot of the sonic aspects of it. But he's from Baton Rouge, actually. He was from Baton Rouge. But it was a trip because I had so many ideas in my head, and it took a long time to narrow down exactly what I wanted to do. You know, and then once I started, you know, playing back everything, it was like, man, like a lot of these songs, like they tell a story of my life. Like I'm very insecure about putting out my own music. You know, so it's like, what if people don't like it? What if people don't, you know, be like, oh, it's not snarky, you know, it's not, you know, it's not Corey Henry. It's not, you know, it's like, yo, man, you know. And then I got to a point to where it was like, after many shots of Jameson, it was like, you know what? I'm me. And I can only be the best me that I can be. That's it. I'm overweight. You know what I'm saying? You know, it's like, you know, I'm not the best looking person in the world, which is what I thought. You know what I'm saying? It's like, you know, yo, but I'm me. And there's only one me. There might be somebody that looks like me, but they can't do what I do. There might be somebody that can do what I do, but they don't look like me. It's only one me. And at that point, it's like, hey, man, get past all of that. So it was like, you know, why take so much time to put out this record? It was like, hey, man, to everything, there's a season. It's time to be born, time to die. You know, to everything, there's a season. And it's like, this was the absolute correct season to put this record out. You know, it's been a great thing. You like it?
I love it. It's great.